stand here, let me compose myself. You can stand with me, please, and let's just sing a couple of stanzas of one of my favorites, number 695. Revive us again.
Suffer many things today in a dream because of him. But
priests and elders persuaded the multitudes that they should act for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate said to them, what then shall I do with Jesus who is called Christ? They all said to him, let him be crucified. Then the governor said, why? What evil has he done? But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that he could not prevail at all, but rather that a tumult was rising, he took water and washed his hand before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. You see to it. And all the people answered and said, his blood be on us and on our children. Then he released Barabbas to them. And when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. May the Lord just bless me upon his word and sanctify our hearts. You may be seated. I want to speak to you this morning for a few moments from the subject of what will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? And a sub-theme of you cannot pass the buck. What will you do with Jesus? And you cannot pass the buck. Jesus Christ makes a claim on every human heart. And every human heart must decide what to do with him. The most important and inescapable question that every human being must entertain is, what will I do with Jesus who is called the Christ? So when Pilate raises this question in this text, which we will investigate thoroughly, what shall I do with Jesus who is called the Christ? It is a question that has continued to echo through the corridors of time for over 1970 years. What will you do with Jesus? Because what you do with Jesus will determine what he does with you. What you do with Jesus in time will determine your eternal destination and the quality of your eternity. Jesus Christ is the most dominant figure of all of history. And he is the determiner of the destiny of every man, woman, every boy, and girl. What I choose to do with them is of grave importance. Matthew chapter 27, verse 11 to 26, Matthew continues his relentless approach to show that Jesus Christ always was, always will be, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. That he is the spotless, faultless, sinless Son of God, and there was absolutely no legal basis for his arrest.
Come on.
So journey with me. And let's travel back some 1970 years to an occupied nation of Israel, to a city called Jerusalem, to a place near the temple, and to the judgment hall where there was a governor by the name of Pontius Pilate, a procurator, who was appointed by Tiberius Caesar. His role was to maintain order and peace over these religious people with all their religious superstitions. It's the 14th day of the Jewish month, Nisan. It's about between 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning. And Pilate has been wakened with the stump on his door by the chief priests and the religious leaders in the rise to come to the judgment hall because they have a convicted criminal that must be sentenced. Pilate has heard about this itinerant preacher from Nazareth, this Jesus. This Jesus who had been betrayed by a close confidant, a man by the name of Judas Iscariot. This Jesus who had been abandoned by his disciples whom he had taught for 3.5 years. This Jesus who had been arrested by the Jewish religious leaders and the Roman soldiers, who had been taken to a Jewish kangaroo court. He had been ushered to the ex-high priest, a man by the name of Annas. Though Annas did not arraign him on any charges, Annas then referred him to the second high priest, a man by the name of Caiaphas. Caiaphas, who tried Jesus in interrogation, he too could not come up with any charge that would stick. But he still brings in the Sanhedrin, this ruling class. tribes of Jewish men, 71 men, including the high priest, and they determined the fate of people in trials that appeared before them. Even though there were no eyewitnesses to any crime that Jesus had committed, they had people coming to fabricate stories, but since no lie can live forever, they could not even corroborate two stories. And so they soak up a charge, and they said that he's been blasphemy, that he claimed to be the Messiah, the King of the Jews. And so they didn't bow on him, and after they had beat him, he's now bruised, he's battered, and blood is streaming out his face. They bind him, and now they take him to Pontius Pilate. They take him to Pontius Pilate because Pontius is the sitting governor. He is over all the legal affairs, and only Pontius Pilate, the governor, can administer the sentence of capital punishment. The Jews not only want Jesus killed, but they want him to be sentenced to death by the Roman government, so it is official. So Matthew, he's chronicling what took place here. And so we come into the courtroom before Pontius Pilate. And there are four things that Matthew shows us in this text. Four things I want to lift in this text. I want to elucidate each point. The first one is he deals with the accusation brought by the Jews. The accusation brought by the Jews. Secondly, Matthew deals with the attitude of Jesus. The attitude of Jesus in light of these accusations. Thirdly, he deals with the animosity of the religious mob that's outside of the courtroom. And then fourthly, Matthew deals with the acquiescence, the capitulation of the governor, the sitting judge, Pontius Pilate. The accusation of the Jews. What we see in this accusation of the Jews, we see the power of jealousy, the destructive power of jealousy, envy, and deceit. And there's no greater destructive jealousy, envy, and deceit than religious jealousy. Amen. Religious deceit. All right. That's why most of our close friends aren't preachers. Because preachers are just too competitive. And there's no war like a holy war between two preachers.
Come on, man.
As a matter of fact, there's a war that's raging out on the national circuit among some of the big-time preachers. They got this thing now to where when they invite each other and they don't get an honorary. What they do is they raise their whole offering. And one big-time preacher at a one meeting raised an honorarium of $200,000. The other preacher didn't want to give it to him. So there was too much money to be taken away from his church. There's no envy, there's no jealousy, like religious envy and jealousy. And the chief priests, the elders, the scribes, they were driven by their envy, their jealousy of Jesus. Jesus had stole the heart of the masses, plain and simple. The masses flocked to him because he taught not as a scribe and Pharisees, not a sterile, doctrinal, legal mandate, but he taught with love, with compassion, and he taught with authority. He literally stole the masses from them, and so they had to rid themselves of Jesus. Now, this particular setting takes place on early morning of Friday, which they would have been observing Passover. We looked at that in recent weeks. And so Passover was one of the holiest days on their calendar, the Jewish Passover. They remember when they had enslaved in Egypt, God sent the death angel to take the firstborn of every child in the nation of Egypt. But God instructed the Jews to kill an innocent lamb and strike the doorpost and the lintel. And when the death angel saw the blood, he would pass over. And so the death angel passed over Egypt. All the firstborn children in the Jewish households were saved. There was weeping and lamenting and gnashing of teeth in the Egyptian household because their firstborn children were killed. And God instructed the Jews, you need to remember Passover, Memorial Day. I want you to remember how I made a difference because you obeyed my word. This was a holy day after Passover. It was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, a seven-day feast and festival. So Passover and Unleavened Bread together, 8 days, a mandatory feast. Every Jewish male above the age of 20 had to make a pilgrimage back to Jerusalem to observe Passover. And unleavened bread. 2.5 million people would stand on Jerusalem. Holy day, a holy time. And so these religious leaders are holy men, and they're devout men, so they're going to keep the Passover, right? There's only one problem. Before they can keep Passover, they got to take care of a little bit of business. And the business they have to take care of is the conspiratorial, premeditated death. adultery or fornication. No one had any premeditation about covetousness. No one struggled with sin this week, but some folk that I do know did have that type of thing.
Wow.
And the problem of premeditated sin on their way to worship God. But God is a gracious God, a forgiving God. We confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us, and He cleanses us from all sin and unrighteousness. But these men were not willing to repent, they were not willing to confess. They were meticulous about observing the man-made restriction. They didn't want to go into Pilate's holy vow before they worshiped God on Passover, but they had no problem with premeditated murder business than that. It's amazing how we can justify our sin when it's not sin. Sin looks pretty bad when it's on somebody else, but when it's on us, we justify it. We can justify our sin because there's a reason why we did what we did, why we cursed somebody out of close to ourselves. We should have said, they just prick my last nerve. They maintain their fastidious commitment to the foolish, arrogant superstition while resolutely seeking to kill an innocent man. So they bring Jesus before Pilate. The witness caught me now. The governor got up out of bed, dressed himself, brought in all of his cabinet. There they are. He had to sit on in judgment at about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning to hear this case. So you know the Pilate is already ticked off. They bring Jesus in before Pilate. And the Pilate had a serious dilemma here. It was threefold. Part of his problem was he didn't want to deal with these religious stuff. He knew the scribes, the Pharisees, and the chief priests. He knew how they were. They were egotistical. They were arrogant. They were power hungry. They were always trying to manipulate things to their advantage. He didn't want to get into this religious swallow. He definitely didn't want to ride on their most holy day. There were so many people who had come to the city. Because Pilate didn't want to deal with Rome, which we'll see here later. He had trouble dealing with these religious people. He had trouble in the past, and he was already on an improvement plan from by Tiberius Caesar to clean the mess up in Israel that he hadn't been able to take care of. And he wanted to call it the middle of this. The religious leaders of the Sanhedrin who bring Jesus to Pilate, they also got the devil in their hands to convince him. They have a legal charge worthy of a conviction, worthy of capital punishment. They have no legal charge to get a sentence. They trump something up, and if you in Luke and John chapter 18, they debate something. They say, we heard this man is forbidden people to pay taxes. And not loyal to Caesar. They hated Caesar. And they hated the fact that they were like a vassal state, these Romans occupying their country, defiling themselves with their presence. But when he came to get rid of Jesus, they said, look, he's against taxation. And Jesus had just said the object. That was the Caesar, rid of the Caesar. That which is God, give it to God. If you live in the state, it provides you certain services, they have the right to tax you, pay your taxes. Give yourself to God. Give your soul to God. Give your spirit to God. Give your being to God. So they're trying to appeal to Pilate to say, look, this guy is an insurrection. He's trying to overthrow the government. The other problem the Sanhedrin had, they wanted Jesus executed, they just didn't want to be responsible for it. Because they thought there might be some repercussion with the masses of people because Jesus was very popular with the masses. They wanted him dead, they wanted him out of the way, but they did not want to be responsible for it. That's why they had him arrested at night, tried him illegally at night, tried to get conviction at night, tried to get the sentence passed before daybreak, before the people got up and milling around town. We were all going to settle the done deal. And the scuttlebutt out on the street would be Pilate that sentenced Jesus to death. Their hands would be clean. And no one will be the wise to know that they were the architects of the clandestine plan to destroy Jesus. That's their problem. They're trying to rush this thing through the court system. In John chapter 18, verse 31, we don't have the time to turn there, but if you read John 18, you'll find when Pilate heard the first words of testimony, he came back and said, I find no fault in the man. So Pilate's first response was a summary judgment in Jesus' favor of innocence, acquittal, case closed, case out, get out of the courtroom, no fault in him, he's not guilty. But the Jews would not relent. They were not going to give up that easily. Even though Pilate concluded Jesus is no threat to Rome, he's not an insurrectionist, he's not a rabble rouser, he's not trying to avoid taxation, even though Pilate said he's not guilty, the Jews are persistent. And so what they do is they go and they stir up the masses. Matthew 27. Look at verse 11. Then Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, saying, "Are you the king of the Jews?" So Jesus said to him, "It is as you say." And while he was being accused by the chief priests and elders, he answered nothing. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" Now look at the attitude of Jesus. He's standing there, serene, totally composed. All his faculties together, even though he's been up there since 6 o'clock Thursday morning, it's now probably about 4 o'clock Friday morning, so he's been up 22 hours. He's been arrested from in the Garden of Gethsemane, taken to Annas, then taken to Caiaphas, then taken to the Sanhedrin, now brought to Pilate. He's been beaten by the Sanhedrin, but he's still there in total control of all of his faculties, able to think cognitively, deductively, and reason, and he said, "It's as you say." But most of Pilate's interrogation, he just simply ignored. And that totally blew Pilate's mind. Pilate had hundreds of men and women to stand before him. But he probably had never had a man standing before him who were facing capital charges that would result in crucifixion, who he, Pilate, thought was innocent, yet the person would put up no defense for himself. That astounded Pilate. That's why you read in the text, Pilate says, "Man, don't you hear what they're saying? Don't you hear them trying to get you crucified? Will you not come to your defense?" But Jesus' innocence was so obvious, it was so clear, it was so blatant, there was no defense that he could offer. How do you defend the truth? The truth cannot be defended. It is the truth. And there he stands there, he's defending the truth. And Pilate knows that he's innocent. And Pilate knows that he knows that he's innocent. But Pilate's thinking, what kind of man is this who will stand here and maybe face execution and not put up any defense? So he's astounded. But Isaiah said he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, like a sheep that is silent before his shearers, he opens not. Jesus couldn't say anything. The prophecy had to be fulfilled. And he didn't have to say anything. Because he was totally innocent. So Pilate finds himself in a real quandary here. He is convinced, he is persuaded, well beyond reasonable doubt, this man is innocent. There's absolutely no charge. The only reason he's here is because of the envy and the jealousy and the arrogance and the selfishness of these religious hypocritical preachers. What am I going to do with this situation? Because they are too powerful in this town. And I've squandered away some situations in the past. He didn't want to offend religious leaders because he knew that they would file a complaint against him with Tiberius Caesar. They had done it before. Pilate was a terrible administrator. He was a wannabe politician, but he wasn't a very good one. He just messed himself up there in Jerusalem when they made him the governor of Israel. One of the things he did, he totally offended the people. Trying to be smart, he brought in these ensigns of Caesar, of Tiberius Caesar. And he had his soldiers parading through the town with these images of Caesar on the back. And the Jews went ballistic. Because you know the Romans were into emperor worship. The Jews went ballistic. They said, "We will not tolerate idolatry. We will not tolerate the worship of a man in our holy city." And they went to Pilate and filed a complaint against him. And so Pilate received the complaint, he hauled all the people up, took them into the amphitheater, and threatened to chop off their heads. And to his surprise, they laid down their necks. They said, "When God is offended, we'll want him to die." And he mocked them, and they called him up, and now he realized, "I'm losing control here." The second major blunder the Pilate had made, and this was about his arrogance, he went into the temple, had his soldiers go into the Jewish temple, he took money out of the Jewish treasury. And he built an aqueduct there in Jerusalem. All right. And they were furious. And they rioted out in the streets. And Pilate sits on his soldiers, they were camouflaged like they were part of the rioters, and they were massacring people in the streets. And the Jews, they never forgave him for that. And some historians believe that maybe there were actual people actually killed in the temple. That's why you get that text that says there was blood mixed with the sacrifice on the altar. They never forgave him. And that was out to get him. The third thing he did, basically left himself totally open to manipulated by them. He's always trying to get brownie points, always trying to suck up to Tiberius Caesar. And so what he had done, he had taken these shields that his men would carry in the battle, and he'd have them to design an image to appear to various seasons. But again, the Jews went off. This time they went to Rome and they filed a formal complaint against him. Tiberius Caesar reprimanded Pilate for that act, made him remove the shields. Pilate is on sinking sand. His political career is dangling by a fragile thread. And now he got this situation, this popular itinerant preacher that has the masses have swelled up to follow these powerful religious hypocrites, and now they're juxtaposed against each other, and Pilate finds himself caught up in a vortex of not knowing what to do. So he's trying to figure out, what am I going to do to handle this thing? He thought he had a solution. He heard, Jesus, this was Galilee. Jesus is from Galilee. Well, if you know what about the old world, Pilate was the procurator, the governor of the whole Israel occupied territory, and then they had what they called the tetrarchs. There were three tetrarchs. There was Herod Antipas, and he was the tetrarch up around Galilee. So Pilate said, since he's from Galilee, Herod Antipas just happened to be in Jerusalem that weekend. Pilate said, take him over to Herod. He's from Herod's town. Let Herod get him. Let Herod have him. So if you want to look at Luke's gospel, you'll find they again bow, they keep Jesus bound, they take him from Pilate's judgment hall, and then they take him to see Herod. Now Herod was a madman, an absolute nut. He had had his brother Philip killed so he could take his brother's wife. And after he had taken Philip's wife, John the Baptist went to Herod, rapped on his door. He said, it's not right that you have your brother Philip's wife. It's sin, it's adultery, and God is not pleased. Herod was afraid of John the Baptist because he saw that this man is absolutely fearless. He has no fear, and there is no intimidation. Herod didn't want to touch him. But Herodias, his new bride, she didn't like John at all. So one night when Herod threw a big banquet, he had all of his heads of state there, and everybody was drunk, and the music was spoiled. Herodias had her daughter going before Herod, and she danced a seductive dance, and Herod's hormones started to kick in. And he said, girl, I'll give you anything you want. Anything you want is yours, up to half of my kingdom. And the young girl had already been canceled by her mother. When he asked you what you want, tell him you want John the Baptist's head on the platter. Herod now finds himself in a fix. She asked for John the Baptist's head on the platter. He's promised her whatever she wanted to have the kingdom on. Now he has to do the very thing that she requested. So they go get John out of prison. And they chop John's head off. They put it on the platter. They bring it and give it to him. But Herod is worried because he says there was nobody I've ever known like John. And when Herod heard about Jesus, he thought that Jesus was John raised from the dead. And he wanted to see Jesus. He heard about his miracles. John didn't do any miracles. He wanted to be entertained by Jesus. So he longed for an opportunity to meet with Jesus. So he laughed. He said, yeah, send the boy over. So they take Jesus over to heaven. Luke 23, verse 8 said, and when Herod saw Jesus, he was exceedingly glad, for he had desired for a long time to see him, because he heard many things about him, and he hoped to see some miracles done by him. Then he questioned him in many words, but he answered him nothing. Jesus would not even dignify Herod's questions. Verse 10 of Luke 23, and the chief priests and scribes stood vehemently accusing him. Had been a boy, treated him with contempt and mocked him, they arrayed him in a gorgeous robe and sent him back to Pilate. And Pilate gets the word, they're coming back. And he drops his head. What in the world am I going to do? So here they come back with Jesus. Back to Pilate. Pilate realizes now I'm pin in a corner. I couldn't pass this thing off to Herod. I can't convince these people this man is no threat to them, to me, or to anybody else. What in the world am I going to do? Had he had the courage, he could have just released Jesus. Because he wanted to be a political power broker, and he was afraid that he would lose more favor with the people, he refused to do so. He feared that a riot would break out. holiday season to show he was not a total ruthless individual. And so Pilate thought, who was the worst person in the jail? Who was the worst person I got in this jail? And he thought, Barabbas! Everybody hates him. The Jews hate him because he disgraced them. Historians say that Barabbas' first name may very well have been Jesus. Because Barabbas means of the Father. Of the Father. Or son of the Father. So they have some name in front of that to get of the Father. What is his name? Son of the Father. And some historians believe that Barabbas' father was a priest. And his name was Jesus Barabbas. He was known as Jesus, the son of the Father, or the son of the Rabbi. Don't look at me too strange. There was nothing unique about the name of Jesus. It was the Old Testament of Joshua, so there were many people named Jesus. It's become very special to us because of Jesus the Christ. And that's how they always identified what Jesus they were talking about. Not just any old run-of-the-mill Jesus, but Jesus the Christ. Or Jesus the Nazarene, are you following? Or Jesus, Joseph and Mary's boy. They were identifying him and distinguishing him from every other young man named Jesus. So Paul says, I'm going to get the worst person in jail. And if I just suppose Barabbas beside Jesus, and I say, which one do you want me to release? Surely they would say Jesus. Because they didn't want Barabbas back on the street. He was notorious. He was a murderer. And an insurrection. And most people use the worst type of insurrections. He was an individual terrorist insurrection. He wasn't even alive with the other groups. Not like us. If you read that chapter, that the rest of the sentence, he would be crucified. The sentence has already been meted out. Otherwise, how could Pilate pull this thing together so fast? He already had three people scheduled to be executed. The two of these rabbis. So Pilate comes back out. He got his game playing together, feeling pretty good about himself. He says that the masses of people, they love Jesus. He's fed them, he's swollen, he's healed, they're sick. He's been compassionate about them. The masses of people, the common folk, they will override the chief priests. And when I say, who y'all want to release? Barabbas? Jesus Barabbas? Or Jesus the Christ? They all say, Jesus the Christ, let's have Jesus the Christ. Please go send Barabbas back to the neighborhood. So how it comes out? Look at the text. Verse 7 to 16 of Matthew 27, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, whom do you want me to release to you? Barabbas or Jesus was called the Christ. For he knew that because of envy they had delivered him. Note how the Matthew continually weaves in Pilate knew what was going on. He thinks he had it this time. But something happens. He makes a great miscalculation of how cunning and how crafty the religious leaders are. And so after he offers them Barabbas or Jesus, he's giving them an opportunity to make their decision, and then Pilate gets distracted. Look what happened. It's right there in the Bible. Verse 19, something unusual happened. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife said to him, saying, have nothing to do with this just man. And she up at 4 o'clock in the morning. And Pilate is sitting on the judgment seat, and it was not a proper protocol for anybody to approach the governor while he was sitting on the seat, convening court, preparing to mete out a sentence. But the wife sends Pilate a message. Don't have nothing to do with this just man. Jesus, I've been dreaming about him all night. He's troubling me. Don't have nothing to do with him. And now Pilate is running upon him. He got the Jews on one side, pressing him. He got his wife on the other side pressing him. And now he's caught in the middle of this whole situation. my life. So while Pilate is distracted, they are manipulating the master. Now look at the text. And I'm almost through. Verse 19. His wife comes, says she suffered many things. Verse 20. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? And Pilate stood burned about himself. He knows they're going to save Jesus. And he's out of this whole quandary. But to Pilate's utter dismay, they shout with a call response in unison, Barabbas! And Pilate gets sick at the stomach. His stomach is in knots now. They're screaming at the top of the lungs, Barabbas, release Barabbas, release Barabbas, release Barabbas. And now Pilate, in desperation, pleads with the people. He pleads with the people, verse 22. Pilate said to them, what then shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ? And his plea is a plea. Please don't tell me I got to crucify him. Please don't tell me you want to crucify him. What shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ? In desperation, he's greatly troubled. And to his dismay, verse 22, they all say, let him be crucified. Let him be crucified. Let him be crucified. And Pilate makes his final plea. What evil has he done? But they cried out the more, let him be crucified. Let him be crucified. So finally we see the acquiescence of the governor. He caves in. He capitulates. He compromises. He knows that he's innocent. He knows he, Jesus is only there because of the envy and the jealousy of the religious leaders. But he thinks about his own career as the governor. And I never made it to the big house in Rome. So for I place up in the town, Tiberius Caesar, he's going to remove me from my place. And he might exile me somewhere. Trying to ease his own conscience. It's kind of amazing what how Pilate does. He actually borrows from a Jewish ritual in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, when the rulers came together, when the judges came together, and if they were just stuck, they could not come up with the right sentence. They didn't know what to do. Because they knew God was a God of justice, and God did not want them to take legal matters lightly, but they just simply didn't know what to do. They would symbolically wash their hands and say, Lord, your will be done, because we just don't know what to do. But Pilate knew what to do. And he knew what the right thing was. But he tries to borrow from his Jewish ritual. And he tries to wash his hands. And he says, I'm clean of this thing. I'm washing my hands of this thing. This man's blood will not be on my hands. In verse 25, the people responded. They didn't know what they were saying was prophetic. They all responded in verse 25. All the people answered and said, his blood be on us and on our children. They didn't know what they were saying. The Jewish nation, right here, they were sealing their fate for at least 2,000 years that the blood of Jesus would be on their hands. And God's hand of chastisement has been against the Jewish nation. He's not allowed other nations to destroy them. He has protected them to show that he is sovereign God. And they were chosen by him by his own sovereign choice. But no people group on the planet had experienced as much persecution as the nation of Israel. And to this day, they are surrounded by Arab Islamic nations who have vowed, we will drive them into the Mediterranean Sea. And there will come a time when the United States of America will not be able to protect.
Wow.
God reigns. His final judgment is final. Discipline upon them. And then they're going to weep and they're going to lament and they're going to mourn, Zachariah says, the one who they killed and crucified.
Amen.
But the blood of Jesus has been on their hands. But not on their hands, but our hands as well.
Amen.
I'm just a country preacher. Saved by the grace of God. And my closest friends always ask me, why do you do all this stuff? Why don't you quit? Why don't you stop? Why don't you slow down? I said, I would if I could. If I could, I would. I'm a prophet. I'm trying to warn people what time it is. Judgment is coming. It's on the horizon. And I don't want saying, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and will open the door, I'll come in and I will sup with him and they with me." What will you do with Jesus? You cannot be indifferent. To walk away from him is to reject him. What will you do with Jesus? Pilate asked that question, standing before Pilate, was the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the ultimate judge, the one who held Paul's eternal destiny in his hands. What will you do with him? What will you do with Jesus, who is called Christ? What will you do with Jesus, who is called Christ? Will you recognize he is your only hope of forgiveness, your only hope for salvation, your only hope to escape the coming wrath, your only hope to escape hell? What will you do with Jesus, who is called the Christ, and you cannot ask above? And you cannot put it off for more convenient time. What the text says in verse 26. Then he released Barabbas to them. And look at this. This sadistic mind. Because he has been embarrassed, because he has been manipulated, because he has been outmaneuvered by these religious hypocritical preachers, he's embarrassed, he's angry about it, and he can't do nothing to them. They have too much leverage against him. What do they do? He takes Jesus and he blames Jesus for his other. So his final act of a sinful, sadistic heart, he calls his Roman soldiers and they scourge Jesus. And they were scourged, the person they were taking, they were tying their hands together, and they were tying them up on a pole where their feet was off, and two scourges would be on either side, and they would have a whip, and the whip would have nine leather straps coming out of it. Each leather strap would have bones or metal on the other end, and they would open it, whip into something, and the leather strap would wrap around the person's torso, and then when they yanked it back, the metal in the bone would rip flesh off them. And it was believed that 40 stripes would kill a man, so unless you want to kill him, you would stop short of 40. And they would beat them senselessly. They would rip the flesh, and it wasn't uncommon according to Josephus. He was destroyed for a person's internal organs to be shorn. How has this done to Jesus? A man that he had acquitted him five times said he's not guilty. I find no fault in him. But when you hold on to your sin, when you hold on to your sin, your fear and your wrath will be bent to the only one that can help is Jesus, who is called Christ. Amen. So a lot of people are angry and they're bitter and they're suffering from emotional trauma, they got anxiety, they got fear because they're holding on to their sin and they know in their own heart I'm a sinner. I can't forgive myself. I'm ashamed of myself. They have to look at a man or woman in the mirror and they cannot escape their own conscience and continue to hot them down. Rather than repent and turn to the Lord, they hold on to the sin. What will you do with Jesus? Because what you do with him will determine what he does with you. Will you stand before him on the day of judgment? As I close, my friend Josephus, scholarly historian, says that about 2 or 3 years after Jesus' trial, Pilate messed up again. They appealed to Rome. Tiberius Caesar not only removed him as the procurator or governor of Israel, but he exiled him into Gaul. And there in exile, a broken, defeated, dejected, depressed man, Pilate committed suicide. And went off into a Christless eternity. If I could summons him this morning, I'll be here to plead with you. If you get a chance to believe in Jesus, trust him as your Savior. If you get a chance to come to the Lord, believe in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. I believe with him. I had my chance and I rejected him. What will you do with Jesus? You can't pass the Lord. What do you do with him? Will determine what he does. When you stand before him to give account for this life that you live. If you would bow with me, please, every head bowed, every eye closed. There's someone here this morning that God has spoken to you. You realize that, like I realize, a little bit of power in all of us. We trying to hold on to something. The Bible says if we try to hold on to our life, we'll lose it. But if we release our life, we'll gain. If you're here today, you sense a need just to get right with God. There's a desire to be saved, to have your sins forgiven. I would encourage you to decide today as to what you will do with Jesus. And that is to believe that he is the only begotten Son of the living God. He lived a perfectly sinless life. He died a substitutionary death. The punishment that you and I deserve was placed upon him. He was raised from the dead on the third day by the power of Almighty God. God himself declared, I am satisfied with the death of my Son and the sins of the whole world. And whoever calls on him shall be saved. Amen. If you're here today, you sense a need to be saved. You have a desire to be saved. I would encourage you to do it today. Yes. Right where you are. We don't do things here for show. Right where you are. You sense God is speaking to your heart. Just raise your hand. When you raise your hand, you say, I want to be saved. I want to be forgiven. Is there one? Is there one?
The storms of life will blow. There's sure
to be such a need to be saved. Just raise your hand right where you are.
They meet me at a time when I am doing.
God bless you. God. Someone else who says to need to be saved. They have a desire to be saved. Just raise your hand right where you are. Don't let this opportunity pass you by. What you do with Jesus today may determine where you will spend all of eternity. So don't let this moment pass you by. No one is going to embarrass you. Someone's going to come and be with you. They're going to take you back and talk to you from the Word of God. Get an opportunity to make a decision. You're not going to have no. Going multiple decisions that you're not going to have. Multiple grace before the church to make you say.
He holds me while I ride. I find safety in his arms while riding.
You sense God is speaking to you. Why don't you do it today? Just raise your hand right where you are. I just want to be saved.
You see, he's the captain of
church, amen?
Amen.
But I would encourage you not to leave here today. There will be someone here, one of the elders, one of the deacons, one of the ladies, somebody here who know how to help you come to the Lord. They'll help you today, and we'll be here for you. The grace of the Lord be to everyone you've come, those who are visiting with us for the first time. We trust that you'll come back to be with us, to experience the grace awakening. Encourage you to be encouraged, to trust and believe. God is still doing great things. He's not lost in power, and all he's looking for people is available. If you make yourself available to him, he'll use you. He'll use you in a mighty way. He'll encourage your heart, will lift your spirit, will give you a sense of purpose, a sense of meaning, and a real sense of destiny. Amen?
Amen.
I want to encourage you to enjoy this day as you reflect upon the goodness of the Lord in your life. Enjoy your family and your friends. Just thank the Lord and bless you to see one more day. And I have a model these days. When I wake up in the morning, I say, well, I know where I am. I know who I am. If I'm able to get about today, this will be a good day. I know who I belong to. I know ultimately where I'm going. This is going to be a good day. This is going to be a good day.
Amen.
So I encourage you to face each day with that same optimism. Every day brings the potential to be a good day, a brighter day, because the Lord will meet you there when you get there. He's already made sure everything will be all right. Amen?
Amen.
One quick note. See, our young people, those who are going to Morgantown, 6 o'clock, 6 o'clock, a.m., Family Christian Center, over there on Patrick Street. Be there, the bus pulls out at 6. I heard you be there at 5:45, right? Brother Greg, 6 o'clock, you're leaving, right? Not 6:01, 6 o'clock. That's why I'm going to Morgantown.